Hello everyone. So we are the last person sitting between you and the lunch, so we would really want to be short, and I promise there would be no math. So today we are going to talk about recommenders, how we employ recommendation systems in mobility. Just a short introduction about ourselves. We are So I'm Anup, and this is my colleague Florian. So we are I'm working as a data scientist at Mobile since last year, and Florian is also working as a data scientist from an external agency called Innovex. So we worked together on this topic for quite some time, and here we are. So today we are gonna talk about this few areas. First of all, we're gonna talk what are the use cases, what are the actual areas where a recommendation system within Mobile can be used properly. We talk about a bit of theory. Maybe it's super easy, but that brings into the picture like why we need to have a better system in place, why something better should be developed. We talk of a particular approach which we came up with, and an example scenario where we show some of the areas where we use this kind of systems, and also talk about a bit of the future, what can be done next. So starting with a bit of intro, like who we are, Mobility is one of the largest marketplace for automobiles, not just cars, but for example, trucks, vans, or even bikes, example. We are located in Dreilinden, which is just outside Berlin, like around 2 kilometers away. We have like around 290 employees, 300 employees, and we are having almost 13.5 million unique users and almost a lot of ads, for example, 1.6 million ads, which includes everything, as I said, like all kinds of vehicles. Over to Florian.
Yeah, and I'm working for Innovex, which is an IT project house focusing on digital transformation. And we have offices in Hamburg, in Cologne, Munich, Stuttgart, Karlsruhe, and Pforzheim. So after the introduction, so what is the actual use case we want to talk about now? So when you consider yourself, you want to go into a shop and let's say you want to buy some kind of handbag or whatever. What you see normally in a shop that you have the complete offering. You see everything, you can engage with a product, you can get inspired by a product you have never seen before. And so you have a really natural way to do this. With a website, it's actually much harder, right? You can't see what's in stock or what the website have in stock. And getting engaged and inspired by a product is much harder. So this is where recommendations actually come into play. So the actual reason to have the same thing that you would have in a real world shop also on the website, that you are able to engage with products, to get inspired by products you have never seen before, and of course also to get recommended relevant products. So these are the kind of user benefits you have from that. And of course, it is always with the business, there are some certain business benefits that get derived by this. So businesses are interested in higher click-through rates or also smaller bounce rates. And yeah, what we see on the left side is a typical first main page of Mobile. So I guess many of you know Mobile. Who has not yet heard of mobile.de? So only one. Okay, perfect. So yeah, speaking about business, there's a so-called conversion funnel you've maybe heard about, and in the case of Mobile, it's the home, the main page. And when you then click on the home page, I'm going to show later more details about this. You get search result page. When you look for a car, you're then able to view a car. If you really like a car, you can put it on a wish list, kind of a favorite list, you know, from many other e-commerce websites. Later on, you can contact the dealer. And finally, like in the realization phase, you buy the car, right? And at every point, of course, you could drop out of this funnel. And of course, one goal is it to maximize your click-through rate to not drop out. And this is and at the various stages of this conversion funnel, we use recommendations to actually accomplish this. So on the homepage that you've just seen, where can we use recommendations, for instance, besides the search mask that you can use to search for a car, we also offer recommendations. So recommendations as an alternative entry point for returning visitors, but also for new visitors to do this inspiration, like to show you cars that you might have not actually searched for, but is but cars that are also relevant to you. And if you now, let's assume you now used still the search mask to actually search for a car, and then you see the search result page. And let's just assume you searched for an Audi A4, and maybe you're not so familiar with cars, so you just heard Audi is a cool brand, and we can use recommendations to actually recommend similar models that like a BMW 3, which is similar to an Audi. And so in this case, we also kind of inspire you. So, hey, why not look at a BMW? Maybe you haven't thought about this. So another engagement. And then let's say you clicked on one of the cars, so you get this view page. And here we can do something like, so you view this car, but how about those cars? They are based on the cars you're actually viewing, but it might be a better offering or just something different. So it's kind of complementing everything. Now, let's say you like the car and you click on the what we call parken. So the wishlist is like setting as it as a favorite. And then you have a wish list of all cars you're interested in. And what happens sometimes is you're interested in a car, but someone else bought the car, of course. And in this case, you kind of want something really similar. You want exactly the car you actually liked. You want to buy a similar one. And we can use recommendations then to also find something, to find the perfect matching ad that is still live, so the item, the offering, I always call it ad, and for the deleted item. Or what we also do is we are complementing your wish list with additional items, with additional cars which are based on the wish list. So we see that in all those four stages, recommendations help to support you and to let you better engage and get inspired by new cars. And then you could contact or then in the end, finally, even buy the car. So as a next step, my colleague will tell you a little bit about the theory, how we actually accomplish this.
Okay, so enough of this. We saw the use cases, how it can be used. So now, how it's actually done. How many of you are familiar with some of the systems, like collaborative filtering, heard before? Okay, great. So I don't want to repeat like the basic math or the basic idea behind, but we want to show you how it is used in our context. So we start off with a very simple car, which looks like this. And let's say a set of users, a set of visitors to your website likes that car or interacts with that car. How? We have seen in the previous slides from Florian, like different stages of interaction. He searched for it, he viewed it, he parked it, or even he contacted the dealers. That could be different degrees of interaction. Now you as a user also like this car. Okay, fair enough. Now this set of users have also seen some other cars, like they are not just restricted to this one, they might have seen some other cars. Now see, like these guys have a similar kind of a behavior on these two cars. And based on that, we can develop a notion of similarity. I'm not getting into that, what kind of similarity, but let's assume for the moment. Once we have this kind of a similarity, we can say like, you can recommend this to you actually, because you also like this car and you have a similar interest pattern with this set of users. And so you can actually recommend this. So getting a bit deeper. We have users, as we say, like almost in the order of 13.5 or 14 million, and we have a lot of, let's say, items. Here, I want to give you an example of movies, because it's a very common example where we have seen or encountered or read in papers. So let's say we have different kinds of Slumdog and Star Wars and like Notting Hill, and people rate it differently. This is a very classical example, and you see like 5 rating being the highest, 1 being like they really didn't like it, and nothing means they didn't watch or they didn't feel to rate that thing. Now, once you see this Star Wars movie, a similar set of users have like a lot of ratings here. Whereas Notting Hill, you have just one guy here who rated it, but others have no say here. So it's kind of a blank cell. Immediately, what you can come up with is this kind of a notion. So you see like these two Star movies with a thick line here, you can say like these are very similar, more similar. Whereas Notting Hill, we don't say it's dissimilar or like unlikely, but it's way more less likely. So that's the basic idea and how where are we kind of going towards the similarity of the idea. So what's important here that should be noted, at any point of time, we didn't look into the content of these movies. We didn't look into who is the producer, director, or any kind of attributes. All we looked into was their relative interactions or degrees of interactions. And when I talk of similarity, a similar or a very simple could be cosine one. Just you take two different kind of vectors and you can come up with a similarity. This is nothing new. You can have different degrees, like we can also have Manhattan or you can have other Dice coefficient, anything like that. So how does it happen in our case? We are not dealing in movies, but in cars. So we don't rate cars. So what can we do? But Florian just said there are degrees of interactions. For example, he can view a car, he can park a car, or he can even contact a dealer. Based on this, we can simply have like our explicit rating, or you can just scale it. It's not hard bound. We cannot say like it has to be 2 or it has to be 5. Just the ordinal kind of rating. So this has to be lower than this and this lower than this, so that it knows like which is higher, which is lower. That's it. Once you do that, you can just have a similar looking matrix as we just saw. Once you have done that, it's pretty easy, because then once we are in the parking, which I just show you like a wish list or the parking example here. So you have liked this car, so you have parked this car, so you have a lot of users have rated those, so you can have some kind of recommendations from there. So just to sum up, what's happening here? So this is you, and this is like all your neighbors, or like say all the other users who have expressed similar interests. So it has a collective behavior at its core. So it knows the likelihood or the interest of other users. It's a very nice and standard method. It's there for decades. It's proven, it's trusted, it's very robust. It's a nice one. Now, how many of you heard of the cold start problem? Okay, subset of those people who heard of recommendations, good. So cold start problem can be of two types, user cold start problem or a item cold start problem. User cold start means when a new user comes to the system, you know nothing about him. And an item is when a new item comes into the system and you don't know how to do it. Sounds simple, but let me give an example. Let's say you have a BMW, a latest model launched today. If nobody interacted with it, you'll never recommend this car to anyone in the next few days. That's horrible. Like BMW is never going to come to your site and say like, okay, we're going to put that there. It's not going to happen. That's really a problem, because what you saw was it has like the items and the people, they have to interact with it. They have to give some kind of input, we liked or disliked. That is the general problem of this collaborative stuff. Second, sparsity. We saw like millions and millions of users, let's say lesser number of items, could be other way around depending on your use case. More than 95-99% would be empty, or the metrics would be super empty. How to deal with such sparse metrics? If you try to compute something similarity on that, the similarities would be near to zero. It's of no use to you. You lose a lot of information. It's not looking into the content. Why not? We know like BMW has a certain engine type, Audi has a certain engine type. We're not at all using those to recommend similar cars. That's bad about collaborative. Second, it has only batch-based learning. What it means, like let's say tomorrow there's another new user coming and a new car coming, and there is some interaction in that matrix or like in that interactive area. We have to retrain everything from scratch. It's not like you just do some online or like an updatable learning algorithm. Let's move on with the different things. So before we get to the next part of the next way of recommending systems, let us introduce a concept of preferences. You as a user has a particular behavior pattern. So we usually call it user profile, but let's say preference, keep it general. So you know what kind of cars you're looking for, because you can also look for new cars. We also deal with used cars, so let's say 100%. You're looking into this kind of brands, you're just only to German brands, and then like only these particular models of those brands. From which area you're coming from, and also like which price range, mileage. Keep in mind, it's totally anonymous. We don't even know, like even if Florian browses beside me, I won't able to see like it's his data. So it's like totally non-identifiable. So it's nice in that sense. So, but we have this kind of information. Now, once we have such a profile, we can have a very, like a preference vector for the user. Let's see how that preference vector can be used. So same car. The same car we saw before in the collaborative part, so now you get talking about content-based filtering. Let's say a price, a car which has got these two attributes, let's say price and category. For space, I just kept two vectors, could be really a large vector of a lot of attributes. And you, as a user, you interacted with the car. Now, before this slide, I just talked about the preference, so I know what kind of car you like. So you can build a preference vector just from the preferences I described before. So, well, fair enough, you just interacted with this car. Now there are two other cars into the system, which is also a small car, a different price, and a high-end sports car. Now I think you already got it. Once you see this fancy and nice-looking vector, you can immediately come up with another sense of similarity, just on this basis. So you know, like, okay, it's 10K small, 6K small, could be similar, but this is like way off your range. It's a sports car. This is not actually what you're looking for. Less similar. So what do we do? Of course, we just recommend this car to you. Nice, right? It also has some problems. Let's see. So first, the good thing is, even if there is no other user, you're the only person in the planet, we will have a recommendation. That's pretty nice, actually. Second, the profile we are building, we can actually add weights to it, because sometimes, often like me or anybody of you, like, have a preference over color. Let's say I only want SUVs or I only want four-wheel drives. So you can add relative preference to each of these vector elements, and that would be taken care of nicely. Second, similar, the cold start problem, like if it's a new user, he never did something on the platform, again, we cannot build a profile on it. We cannot know what his preference is. So that's something Florian will mention later. And this is a bit of a general statement for content base. It's not applicable for different kinds of items. For example, of course, we are not like Amazon, where we sell books and DVDs and also PS4s. Not like that, but just for general information, you cannot apply for where you're selling like different kinds of item, because the inherent vector would be different. And of course, you have low diversity, because when you saw before, if you're like a 10K small category of preference, you would be always be recommended those kind of cars. You would never have something different or a bit of diversity there. So what can we do better?
Yeah, so now that we've heard about the different theories about collaborative filtering, content-based filtering, what is our approach? How we can combine this into something better? So again, to our actual question, we wanna find a perfect car. So for her, this would be then a big red fire truck. And just to recapture again, what do we have? We know the preferences of her. We know what kind of cars she likes. We also have the interaction of the other users. So this would be then the collaborative aspect that we've just learned about, which we somehow want to include. And we have also have the content of the items, all the attributes of the car, make, model, the color, and so on. And we have other requirements, so requirements by Mobile directly, in a way that we want to be flexible, we want to address all the different use cases. We also want to cope with the cold start problem. If you imagine a website like Mobile, where people sell used car, there's only one used car, right? So if the used car is gone, it's not like you can have exactly the same used car. So the inventory is changing really fast. So the cold start, the item cold start problem is therefore really high. And also the cold start problem of the user, since you are not buying a car on a weekly basis. And of course, everything has a certain uncertainty with it, right? So if a new user starts being on the website, it's kind of you don't have the perfect car preferences right from the start. I mean, the longer you use the website, the more we know your preferences, but there's some certain uncertainty. And of course, we want to update this and capture those ideas in real time. So what we came up with is like a combination, a hybrid recommender based on the collaborative filtering that we've just heard and the content-based. And the idea is to mixture them in a way to combine their advantages and kind of reduce their disadvantages to not have the cold start problem for new items. So this would be then the part of where the content based filtering comes in. Then also to integrate new users. This is something we do with the help of Bayesian inference. So if a completely new user comes on the website, we assume it's like a default, like an average user. And then while you are interacting with the website, we do Bayesian updates to actually move your user preferences more and more to the actual state. And of course, and really big important big aspect, as Arnab said, is that both components, content-based and collaborative filtering, are really robust and reliable concepts. So they're really in practice used, and so this is a good thing to build something on something reliable. And another really important thing is that what you have heard in the explanations of Arnab, it's really easy and comprehensible, and this is also important if you want to do something in production. We might have to debug something, so it's good to have something that is comprehensible. So how does our architecture actually look like? So assume you are visiting mobile.de, and what is happening is that on a user preference service is using your user preferences to personalize the website. At the same time, new events, new interactions, as been said before, like you park cars, you view cars, you contact a dealer, are stored in a user event storage tracking system for analysis and to actually update then your user preferences. So they are updated in real time, but also stored for later trainings and data science purposes. And the user preferences are then also used by the recommendation engine. And the recommendation engine uses then Elasticsearch to actually build on your profile a query, which I'm going to show in the next slide, to then get a recommendation for you on the website. So that's the overall architecture, like from a really high view. And the different technologies we use here, just to name a few, is Kafka, as many people do. Then we do Hadoop, Hive, Spark. Of course, a lot of services are implemented as REST services based on Java and Scala and Cassandra and also Python. And the collaborative filtering is right now done in Mahout. So how does this now work? Also from a high level perspective. So what we do is the similarity aspect of the content of the collaborative filtering is also stored in Elasticsearch, and then we use the preferences as well as the similarity between different cars in the Elasticsearch to form a query, and this query is just evaluated in Elasticsearch, and what we get back from Elasticsearch is a ranked list of vehicles, and we can take then the highest scored cars on this ranked list as a recommendation. And here's also where the flexibility comes in. So since we can then change how we generate this query to Elasticsearch and how much we boost different aspects, for instance, the collaborative part or more like the content-based part, we are really flexible to adapt this to different use cases. So Arnab is going to give you a small example now.
So yeah, so now we're going to talk about a small use case, so which is about finding a similar car model. This is an example about collaborative filtering. I'll show you some small code snippets from Python and how this thing is done. So this is not an example of a hybrid, just to clarify. So This picture was shown in the initial phase of our talk, like where we're talking of motivation. So the idea is people, when they're looking for their first car or a new car, whatever, they're a bit uncertain what they want. So the idea is to drive our users to a more informed or a more channeled search in that sense. Like, okay, if you have want to find this, you can also try this. Why not? So that's the keywords, like they're a bit uncertain and they want to explore similar models. And here it's the collaborative aspect of it. So before I dig into it, so the what we are using here, LightFM, anybody heard of it? I used it before? None. So it's a very nice, I highly recommend this. If it's you're working with recommender systems in Python, please try it. It's very nice in the sense it has got really nice capabilities to parallelize your code, do some training on like multiple cores and stuff like that. You can have different kinds of recommenders. For example, you can try it very simple, content-based or collaborative, and also like any learning to rank function. So basically, if you have a ranked list of results, you want to optimize for some score, you can do that. So for example, BPR or WAP, these are like different methods they have, like weighted approximation and stuff like that. So overall, it's nice, very nicely documented, actually. So we are using, in our use case, this particular library. And let's see how it's done. So let's go back to that matrix we are talking of, users and items, again. This can be represented, for example, like a matrix M, which is defined in the order of number of rows and number of columns. This means cardinality of U means the number of users in your data set or in your database. I means the number of items. This means the cardinality, meaning the size of the set. So that's the definition of your matrix. The idea is, as I said, it's extremely sparse, extremely sparse. To split this matrix up into two different matrix, which is a left and right, just to clarify the thing. How? By porting the whole data into a much denser intermediate latent space, which is given by this LF, meaning like latent features. And just from matrix multiplication, if you come from this side, it's like the number of columns should be equal to the number of rows, otherwise you cannot multiply, of course. So you just break this thing down into much smaller, much condensed, yet having the same information content. Why are we doing this? Because our problem is to find similar car models. Had we started from here, if you see like this, you have like 13 million entities here. Maybe just 10 or 20 people have rated it, you would have near zero similarity. I'm just repeating, I already mentioned this, so that wouldn't have helped us. So we need to find a space where it's much more denser, where the similarities makes more sense. We are dealing with this part of the matrix. If your use case wants to find similar users, you can use this part of the matrix, because once you see this user, you can see like, okay, this users can be represented by this rows, like a vector representation, and you can do the similarity in a way. So let's start with this part. So what we have is this guy, and then when we have this column representations, which is extremely compressed, we call them item embeddings. Like if somebody is from NLP backgrounds, we have word embeddings, which is like also a representation of words in extremely high dimensional space. So this is like representation of this car in this latent space. That's the exact analogy to put it in words. So words, the items are represented as embeddings, and once you have that, it's super simple to define such kind of function or a score. Whatever the similarity, you can hand code your similarity function or use any standard vector, whatever you can use. And once you do that, you can have, let's say you have 10 cars, you can have like a 10 cross 10 matrix. For here we had like around all different make model combinations. So basically BMWs, all the models of BMW, Audi, all the models. So we had around 1900 or 2000 entities, and every such item. So every such item was encoded as had an item ID. And what you see here is like a pairwise similarity. Of course, this diagonal is like comparing the item with itself, which is of similarity one. And so basically we're looking for this area where that means these scores, like for example here, like all the yellowish white ones are the high similar make model combinations. The dark ones like totally dissimilar. That's the core idea. As I said, so to see like how LightFM, how simple it is to use, for example, this is from our production code base. So basically you just fit a, let's say, constructor. We don't have like in Java, like you just define your loss function, what kind of optimization, item alpha, like the regularization, just to avoid any overfitting. You don't want to overtrain your model. and the number of components. This is basically the definition of the number of features. If you have a million items, if you say two, it's fine, but it's you have to do a bit of optimization there, try out what number of features. So we had around 50 to 60 number of intermediate features. Once you have that, you just do a fit, very similar to any machine learning algorithm. You just have a model, model.fit, your training data, which is given by this. Epochs, number of times you want to pass the data to find your nice fitting parameters, and the degree to which you want to optimize. That's it. And this part is basically the our snapshot from a MongoDB where we persist our similarity scores. So this is the guy we are looking for, BMB645, and these are the top K results. So we always persist not everything. Of course, we have so many makers, just the top 10 probably right now, and with individual scores. That's it. So just to give a complete wrap up. So hybrid is something, is solving multiple things together. First, it's the best of both the worlds. It's really getting to the ideas together. Robust, in as Florian mentioned, it's very robust, both the methods. Users, they have a bit of engagement because they see like different kinds of cars, be it a new user, be it a new car. So you have served both the problems. They also get a bit of diversity. And of course, the most important, business is happy because they see a bit of raise in their CTR. They see more and more people clicking on the recommended cars and stuff like that. And yes, so now let's see what we can do in the future, actually.
Yeah, besides like the more traditional methods we have used, which is always good if you want to get something in production and also really fast. I mean, it's good to build on something reliable that you know your works. But of course, at the same time, you always keep your site open to the new things. And the new kid on the block is deep learning. And deep learning can also be applied to recommendation system. Just you've surely heard of all the recent breakthroughs that you can do skin cancer detection, can deep learning do much better than any physician. And yeah, even things like playing poker is almost impossible to win a heads up against a deep learning based poker bot. And of course, when you start to look into a new technology, you have to ask yourself, why am I actually looking at this? And one thing that deep learning promises is that it allows you to capture nonlinear relationships. And so far, we have only heard about methods that actually look only at linear relationships. And you have to build some of the features yourself. And with the help of deep learning, you have less feature engineering, almost to none. And because nonlinear relationships are much better captured. It's also a holistic approach. So we're looking at one model where you would not need to have those two components that we have right now in our hybrid recommender, that we have a more collaborative filtering part and a content-based part, which is also a gain if you reduce the complexity of your system. And of course, in the end, we want to have an improved quality. So I'm just going to show you, also due to the time, a quick look in the system we're using. We're using one model of Google, of a Google paper that they use in the Google Play Store, the so-called wide and deep model, and how that model works. So I just assume you've already heard a little bit about deep learning and neural network. So let's say we have a car and the attributes of a car, some continuous attributes like price and mileage. We have to encode them, to put them in a range of 0 to 1, and so to standardize them. And the same thing we also do for our user with the history of the user. And also here, things like an average price or a certain price range a user is interested in is encoded so that it can be an input to the network. The same is done for categorical. Here you do normally a one hot encoding, but this is not so important. So in the end, we do also some embedding. So this is basically the same idea that Anup just explained about the latent feature space. You have here again in the world of embeddings. And then the cool thing about the wide and deep learning model is that you have actually two parts. So you have a so-called deep part. So here, these red bars show the different layers of our neural network, which get more and more narrow. And this deep component is actually really good to get the overall concept, to get the overall idea. So if you look for big cars with a lot of seats, which are maybe not so fast, if you're looking actually for a family car, then this part would get this idea, because on each of those layers, you're kind of abstracting away from the specifics more to a general idea. But at the same time, some people really want to have one Volkswagen with a sport edition, whatever. So here is where the white component comes in. The white component does cross-item relations directly to capture this, if you're really user that want to have something really specific. And both of those parts are then combined into one output in the neural network. And in the end, you get the probability that a user X likes vehicle Y. And then what you can do is, if you have a user given, then you can just, from a candidate list, just try out where the probability is the highest. You get by this ranking of the different vehicles, and the highest ranked are then the recommendations. So, but this is something we are working on right now, which is not yet in production, but it already shows really promising results. So to conclude our talk, so what have we learned? We have seen that recommendations support the users in all the different varying stages. And to find the perfect car based on the preferences of the user, and of course also of a collaborative aspect. So thank you for your attention. And do you have any question?
Hey, thanks again for the talk. You just mentioned using Mahout currently. Do you have any plans of exchanging this component, or is it can maybe can you highlight the reasons why you took have chosen Mahout?
So, yeah. So the question was, why are we using Mahout, and if you want to replace it? It's definitely we want to replace it. It's so Arnab already showed this with Light FM, and it was something that we built on. So it's currently Mahout is not really developed so much more anymore. So there's definitely a need to go back, but it was also something that was already in place and we built up on it. But you're completely right. So we want to change back, and we hope to even go directly to something more deep learning based then.
I was wondering if you could say something about how you measure the quality of the recommendations, or how helpful they are, and also if you've ever found any surprises, like cars that should have been super interesting for somebody, but turns out are not popular.
Yeah, exactly. Like when we are working with the Light FM part, so they have this inbuilt training test, that kind of model. So we train like on our whole outside to see like how good is actually the predictions, or like how good is the model. So it's simple. We just wanted to find out what are the approximate ratings item would get, so we know how the model is. Now we put this into production, or you put it out, and we generate this top kill list, and there are like, it's a bit difficult in the sense because it has a user and a human element to it. So users who are used, let's say we have a marketing team, they want to see that. So they say, yeah, it looks good, but the third, I don't want the Volkswagen, there is something coming up. To be honest, it's a bit difficult to handle because we are not hand tuning in each and every item. So that's what the model is coming up. Then sometimes we see like some items are not adequately rated, or like some items are really an old timer. So a bit of pruning is there, like just to see like are all the views or are the ads nicely viewed, or like in a good frame of time, going back 6 months, not going back ages, because that doesn't help in your recommendation. So it is a bit of going back, fixing stuff, and again seeing how the results look. So it's a bit of qualitative, like a manual check in production. So
yeah, but basically, so we have an offline part where you have all some kind of different metrics on a test set, and then online it's an A/B test. And then because there sometimes is a huge difference between you optimize something for offline usage, but you will then only see online that actually it's something different. And yeah, so and then there can be certain surprises, but nothing really specific. So I don't remember.
In one of the talks before, Xing mentioned that they have an implicit feedback system of their recommendations. So when they recommend, for example, a job position or whatever, the customers have the possibility to rate or say something like, do not show more like this. And I'm not aware of many e-commerce systems offering such things. What are your thoughts on that one?
Definitely, that's a good idea because implicit feedback definitely helps you to improve more and more. Right now, we don't have something like that in place, but definitely with more advanced like deep learning or stuff like that, we want to have those components there. And also, like from the product perspective, like it's not just the tech part. So there is no such plan like to have like an explicit like dislike kind of a button, things like this. So the idea, like generic idea, is like okay, if you viewed something and you called, it is an explicit feedback in some sense. If you didn't, we say it like, well, you don't know, like let's say as good as zero. So that's the best assumption we can make. Any more questions? Okay. Thank you.